so you guys have to keep track of who's reading because I forget. Oh, that's right. Okay, Johnny, you want to go ahead and read this slide? Okay, so this was the first birth in the Bible. Like I said, she gave birth to Cain and Abel. Now, one thing to focus on here is Abel kept look over the flock, which is the live animals, and Cain worked the soil. This thought really means nothing. But my original thought when I was going through this, and I'm getting a little ahead, but animals, livestock, we know, cost more than soil or fruits. And I was like, I feel for Cain a little bit on how Abel's, because his was live animals, and that was, we used later on to find out that they're used for sacrifice for sins. So animals got more meaning behind them than fruits. And I started thinking that that's why, Cain got mad at Abel, but we're going to find out later that's not exactly the reason. But that's where my mind went before I did a deeper study. So yeah, this is the first birth recorded in the Bible. Of course, the spelling wasn't right here, but Cain was to look over the land and Abel was to look over the animals. And I looked up, because in the Bible, meanings had names behind it. I forgot what Adam and Eve's names meaning were. I don't know if we discussed that, but anyway, the meaning of the name Cain is Hebrew for brought forth or acquired. So back then, names are really, when you think about it, that's kind of a generic name. Oh, we're going to call him brought forth. He's our first son. He's brought forth. I think Cain was, I don't know if he was the first or second, but anyway, Hebrew for brought forth. Yeah. Okay, what did Abel, what did that mean? I think I know where I found this, and if I did, because I got it from David Guzik. I'll tell you here in a minute. I could be wrong, but I think, yeah, Genesis 4, Cain and Abel, the birth of Cain, and I don't know if I got it from David Guzik or I got it somewhere else, but I want to say David Guzik even says, let me see if it's on here. I'm looking at my phone. Okay, and before Cain, I said, I have acquired a man from the Lord. Okay, the name Cain, and this is from David Guzik. The name Cain basically means I've got him, or here he is. It is likely Eve thought that Cain was the seed that God promised, the deliverer who would come from Eve. I think I got it from somewhere else, but David Guzik basically says the same thing. And David Guzik, if you guys like David Guzik, enduringword.com. He's got commentaries, YouTube videos. Some of his YouTube videos are good. He's got questions and answers. It's just, yeah, if you guys like David Guzik, check out his website. It's amazing. It's been very useful for me. And this is for anybody out there that's listening to David Guzik. He just He's an amazing man of the Lord. I get a lot of information from him. All right, Brenda, you want to read this slide?
In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord, and Abel also brought an offering, fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast.
Okay, I think you know this answer, Brenda, so I'm going to ask Johnny and Peter, why do you suppose the Lord looked over Abel's offering but did not accept Cain's offering? Any idea why you would think that's so? I'm going to give you the answer in a minute, but I want to see what you got. I want to see if you guys have an idea. Yeah, Abel's over the livestock, Cain was over the fruits. Or over the land.
Because he was just. Well, because he brought the firstborn of his flock, I think.
Yeah, Cain brought the first fruit of the flock. Cain brought the first fruit of the land, basically fruits. Like I said, my initial thought is wrong, but my initial thought was Cain got mad at Abel because Abel's offering had more money value to it than Cain's, but God doesn't care about money. Money's meaningless to God. Do you suppose that maybe Cain's motives might have been wrong? And maybe Abel had a better motive besides Cain? Okay, that's pretty much the answer. And here's my notes here. Abel's offering was accepted because his offered according to faith. Apparently, Cain just did it because he was supposed to do it. This can be seen in Hebrews 11:4. Now, this is in the New Testament, but this is where I got my resource from. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commanded as righteous when God spoke well of his offering. And by faith, Abel still speaks even though he is dead. So basically, it's saying that Abel gave through faith. Cain just did it because he had to. But Cain did it faithfully. Like, when we give offerings to church and stuff like that, if we're giving it because we're supposed to give 10%, God doesn't want your money if you're giving it to him because you have to. But if you're giving it to him because you feel faithful and loyal and you're giving it because you want to give it, then that means more. You guys can kick me, somebody can help me on YouTube or on Facebook. My spew on this is, yes, we do need to give tithes and offerings. The Lord's led on my heart because 10% right now, I just can't see me able to do 10%, but I give time. But God told me, give me at least 20 a week. I know it's not 10%. I know it's not what you should be giving. But if I can give them $20 weekly and be faithful about it, God's been showing me, if I can show him just a little faith, he'll show me a little reward. And I think the more we lean on God, the more he shows us that we're faithful to him, that he will reward us. And I want to watch how I say that, because I'm not doing it for the reward. It's not, well, okay, if I give you 20, you can reward me this much, so how much more reward will I get if I give you 100? That's not why I'm doing it. But God is revealing to me, the more that I'm faithful to him, the more I get back. Like, for instance, with my calling being a bus driver. Well, normally on Fridays, if I get asked to do something extra, I'm like, no, I can make more money with DoorDash. I don't like taking away on Fridays. Well, they asked for somebody to fill in a supplemental on a Friday, and I started thinking, it's like, well, this is what the Lord wants me to do. He wants me to focus on the bus. So I was faithful, and I was like, all right, I'll take one of those supplementals. I was still able to DoorDash. Obviously, it was only for a few hours, so making my goal wasn't going to happen that day because of, you know, helping with the bus. I get a simple reward as a delivery, and I got like a $15 payout for a single delivery. From a Wendy's, that showed like $6.50 or $7.50. It was petty, but God still showed me that if you're faithful to me, I'm going to reward you even with these petty things, just to show that he still got her back. And I think Ty's the same way. Yeah, and that's kind of where I'm at the $20 mark right now, is I can do that faithfully, and I can do that with a smile on my face, but 10%, I feel like if I do that, I'm only doing it because I have to, and at that point, that money is absolutely meaningless. I might as well throw it in the trash at that point.
I have a question.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, like, if it's meaningless to God, why do we need money in our lives for? If it's meaningless to Him, like, shouldn't that be meaningless to us?
Yes and no. I mean, we live on Earth. We're earthly bound. We got earthly thoughts. I don't know if the straight yes, and I don't think it's a straight yes or no answer, but. Let me ask you this, Johnny. If you didn't have money, if you didn't make money, would you be able to survive?
No.
Okay.
Probably not, because it's weird.
I get you. And it's a valid question, Johnny. And money shouldn't mean anything to us. Where I say money is meaningless is God saying, like, let's say, for instance, all you make is $100, and there's been people like our pastor and stuff, how they do it, only God knows. Well, obviously it's because God's got their back, but like, let's say if all you're making is $100 a week, you can't survive on that, but God's like, if you're faithful and if you give 10% of that, which is $10, and you're doing it because it's faithful, and you know that's what God wants you to do, and you're doing what God, and God tells you to give that 10, and you give that 10%, which is $10, $100 a week.
I can't answer that right now.
Then he'll supply the rest of your needs.
Hey, I got a question to Christopher.
Yeah.
At my church, right?
Yeah.
It is good to ask people for money. Like the people, I used to go to church, and it's good to people put money in a basket, like
Yeah, and giving money to the church, we're supposed to do that. I mean, the Bible says give faithfully, and we're supposed to give to the church. The motive behind it is what makes it either good or bad. If we're doing it to bring forth God's glory, that's great. Now, if it's a church, like, let's say they're doing it because somebody, and I'm trying to watch how I say it because I'm not criticizing anybody, because tithing and offering is important, and obviously we're supposed to give 10%. And but God wants us to give faithfully. He don't want us to give so, because a pastor is not supposed to take that money and just do whatever he pleases with it. Now, granted, that's how he makes his money. That's his income. So he is, you know, he's entitled to so much. And now that's so much, as long as he pays his bills and he pays his 10%, or, you know, his tithing back, God says, whatever you got left, you can do whatever with. So, like, let's say they want to go out to eat. They don't need to, but they want to go out to eat, or they want to go to the movies. Well, I got an extra $20, but all my bills and necessities are paid. God says that's okay, because we're still allowed to have, we're still allowed to have pleasures on this earth, but it can't, we're still allowed to enjoy life. It's just got to be something that God can smile upon. Not like going to a strip club, which, yeah, it's pleasing. Some people enjoy it, but God don't smile upon that, because that's lust. But going to a movie and watching a Christian movie, a movie that, a family movie, something that's not bad, God's okay with that.
Okay.
Now, to answer your question, I know I kind of drug it on a little bit, but try to answer the best I can without stepping on toes. Alright, you want to go ahead and read this slide, Johnny?
Then the Lord says to Cain, why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it.
Okay, anybody got any comments before the minutes?
The little angry face.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Yeah, anger's a weird subject. It's not good, but even Jesus got angry. That's why we get angry is what matters. Are you trying to preach to me, Peter?
No,
you're fine, Peter. I struggle with this myself. That's why I say, are you preaching to me? Because I understand. I know we're not supposed to get angry. We get angry for stupid stuff.
Yeah. Why be angry? Be happy.
Yeah, we're supposed to be happy. Hold on. I know. Oh yeah, this is a big cookie. cookie.
Oh my God. That's a big one. That's bigger than the moon. Oh my God.
Okay. Here's my notes here. God lets Cain know that he should not give into sin. He should overcome it. I believe it is also talking about temptation, that he shouldn't give in to temptation.
I was to ask you.
Yeah.
I seen homeless people. I give $3, like $3 or $5. That's good or bad.
Yeah, I'm not gonna dog that, because I've done that too.
God's watching us.
Yeah, because we don't know their motives. When we do that, we're hoping they really need it. I try to watch myself when it comes to panhandling, because there's a lot of them out there that's just out there for money or whatnot. My thoughts are, you know, if I go to help somebody like that, I'll give money sometimes, because it's easier to give money, but if I have time and I have a little extra, instead of giving them money, like I did this to one guy. I'm like, hey, I'm getting ready to go into Kroger's. Is there anything I can get you? Because usually if you do that, and if they're really in need, they're like, yeah, you know, I can use such and such. And then, but, you know, giving money, there's nothing wrong with that. And if, basically, I'm just going to tell you this way. If in your heart you feel like God tells you, give them this $3, then give them the $3 and don't even think about what they're going to do with that money. Just give it to them because that's what God tells you to do. Because God does speak to us that way. If he tells you, hey, if you see a homeless guy, give him $3. Give him $3. Yeah, you know, if that's what the Lord leads you to do.
That's sad. That's sad. People don't have nothing.
Yeah, and it is sad. But what's really sad is there are people out there that really are in need. And then you got people out there that are just begging to see what they can get. When, and I'm trying to watch my words because I understand people are struggling. I understand it's hard to find jobs. But there's jobs out there everywhere, and some of them, they just don't want to work, and they make more money doing that than they would be getting a job, which is sad. But I'm going to leave it at that because I'm not dogging them because they really need help. They need help. I'm just dogging the ones that are out there that aren't legit, that are out there, you know, using people. And that's when it's okay to be angry, is if you know somebody is out there taking advantage of people, it's okay to be angry, but what you do with the anger is what matters.
No, angry, no.
Well, even Jesus got angry, but he got angry because his people were being taken advantage of. Because remember, even in the Bible, he flipped tables and stuff like that. So even Jesus got angry. But it's the reason why we get angry and how we deal with it. Now, if we get angry at somebody because he badmouthed you or whatever, and then you get into a fist fight, yeah, that's clearly a sin. That's the wrong way of dealing with anger. But if you get mad because somebody is stealing money from somebody that's needy, and then you go up and you confront them and you talk to them, not yell at them or not beat them up, but talk to them and tell them, hey, this ain't right. Can I pray for you or something like that and take your anger that way? Then yeah, you can be angry. You can even be angry at God. But when we get angry at God, God wants us to confront him about it and work it out with him and not just leave it at being angry with him. And I like what you say, because I know David Guzik has some of this. I'm trying to, when I do my Bible study, I don't want to say not use David Guzik, but I'm trying not to use him for everything, because he's had a lot of interesting stuff to say here. And you pretty much covered some of what he says. But I'm trying to limit David Guzik to when I really need him, at least for our Bible study, because I'm trying to be... trying to watch out. I want to glorify God, but I don't want to feel like I'm just taking everything somebody else said and just running with it. So I'm trying to do like Pastor Cliff was pointing out, you know, do your own commentary and then look after what somebody else did. So I'm trying to focus more on my own. And then I do look at David Guzik sometimes, and there's going to be times here and there I'm going to pull from David Guzik. But I've noticed in the past that a lot of my study might be 50% me, 25 to 50% David Guzik, and some Bible notes, which nothing wrong with that. But I don't want to use David Guzik as a crutch. I want to use it as a tool, and I'm trying to learn on, trying to work more on trying to do, I almost want to say on my own, but I can't say my own because I've always got the spirit. Just like how I told you my initial thoughts on the offering, and I do get some of this from David Guzik, and I bring it in here, but I'm not putting everything he does on here. But if I'm copying his words down, then I will put it on here, and I will let you know that, you know, this is David Guzik. This David Guzik said this, because I don't want to take away from David Guzik, but I also want people to see that I'm putting in an effort and not just, well, here's what David Guzik said to all this, and just doing a copy and paste, because copy and paste ain't a Bible study. Bible study is actually reading it, meditating, and seeing what it says to me. And then if I don't understand something, that's when I'll turn to the commentaries. But if, like, certain things make sense, or I think I got a good input on it, certain things I don't even need commentaries for, but I'm using it for a tool and trying to use it more as a tool and less of a crutch. And it seems like I've been using it as a crutch, and I'm trying to use it more of a tool than a crutch, if that makes sense.
Yes, sir.
Right. All right, so whose turn is it to read? Now,
oh my God.
Does that seem like premeditated murder to you guys? Like he thought that out?
Yes.
That's the first murder in the Bible. He thought that one out because, look, okay, before that, we're going to go right back here. I'm going to read this again. Then the Lord said to Cain, because God knew that he was going to do this, why are you angry? God even asked him, why are you angry? Why is your face the downcast? And I'm going to look up the meaning of that word for a minute. I know that word's important. If you do what is right, will it not be accepted? Basically saying, do what's right and I'll accept it. You do what's wrong, I'm not going to accept it. But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at you. Basically, if you don't do what's right, sin's got you. Okay, that brings my thought that I was going to bring earlier, and I couldn't quite figure out how to word it. If you don't do what's right, giving in to sin, you're giving sin a foothold. Like, for instance, road rage, okay? When somebody cuts me off, I got two options. First option, which most, I don't want to say normal people, but what a lot of people do is, beep, you stupid, you know, and cut them off and stuff like that. When I do that, I'm giving in to sin, and I'm giving Satan a hold of me. And you give him a little bit, you give Satan an inch, he's going to take 2 miles. Now, the other aspect, and I'm working on this, I'm getting better at this, is somebody cuts me off. Obviously, you know, my first thoughts are, and lately, since I've been working on it, sometimes I don't even notice it because I'm not paying attention, and I think that's intentional by God. But other times, I'll just take a deep breath, or I'll like, you know what? Who knows what their story is? Because I could blow the horn at somebody. It could be somebody in labor, somebody that's trying to get to the hospital, and you're getting mad at them, and then if you knew their story sometimes, you'd feel like an idiot afterwards. So basically, long story short, when it says, do what is right, sin is crouching at your door, basically, if you do what's right, then you're not giving Satan a foothold. Now, I did say I was going to look up the word downcast because I know that word is important. I can't remember. So I'm going to go to Webster's Dictionary and see what it says. I know that word's important, so. And I don't always put things down when I see them, and I put down what I think's important. I go through like here, and I'm like, maybe I should have put that down there. Okay, downcast. Dejected. Directed down. I don't think that's... Okay, Google. What is the biblical meaning of the word downcast?
According to People's Defender, the word downcast is synonymous with dejected, gloomy, despondent, broken-hearted, miserable, wretched, grief-stricken, crushed, and depressed. I'm here to tell you that if you've ever felt like this, you're not alone.
Okay. You guys understand what that said? Or do you want me to read it again?
Okay.
So basically, downcast is being depressed, angry, sad, stuff we're not supposed to be.
Okay.
Trying to give you guys a chance, because I'm trying not to do all the talking. But instead of asking each time, I'm trying to learn to just be silent for a little bit and give you guys a chance to speak up. And if I don't hear anything, I'm moving on. But I'm trying to give you guys a chance to... Yeah, that's the first murder in the Bible. And then this was my notes here. Cain was so angry that he let his anger take control and killed Abel. This is the first murder in the Bible. Okay. Basically, all but the liars. Have you ever let your emotions take control of your actions? Yeah, I say all but the liars would say yes. road rage is my, like I said, and I'm getting better at it. And the more we work on something with, you know, praying to God and not doing it on our own, but the more we let God help us through something, the better we get at it. I think it's your turn now, ain't it, Johnny?
Yes.
Okay.
Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother Abel?" "I don't know," he replied. "Am I my brother's keeper?" Oh, I read this in Genesis last time in my Bible.
Yeah. Now, you know the funny part of this? He really was his brother's keeper. Because I think Cain...
I think
I got it from David Guzik, but I think I remember somewhere saying, yeah, I think it was, I'm almost positive it was David Guzik. He actually was his brother's keeper.
I didn't even know there was murder in the Bible, to be honest.
Oh, yeah, there's more than that. David murdered, I forget who, Bathsheba's husband, because he wanted her. But yeah, there's been plenty of murders in the Bible. It's just, it's not a godly thing, but it's in the Bible because, like here, it's important.
The army people.
Oh no, Cain lied to God. That's not good. God knows all. So why do you think God asked Cain, "Where is Abel?" When God knows the answer, why do you suppose God asked Cain where Abel was?
Because he knew what Cain did to Abel.
Okay, but why do you suppose that he asked him that? Because, yeah, God knew what Cain did to Abel, but why do you think God asked Cain, "Where is Abel?" Do you suppose that maybe God was giving him a chance to confess? And think about it. All Cain had to do is say, "I'm sorry, God. He's out there in the field. I just killed him." But instead, he lies to God and tries to cover it up. And we all know we can't lie to God. All right, Brenda, I think it's your turn, ain't it? You want to go ahead and read this?
Longer on the earth.
You guys think that's a little harsh of a punishment?
Yes.
With God's way, I think.
Yeah, God, he's a vengeance God, but he's a, what am I trying, there's a word I'm trying to think of. He's a jealous God. Because he don't want us to have any gods ahead of him. He wants to be number one in our lives. He is a jealous God. And that's biblical. I'm not, that's not just Chris Burns saying that. That's biblical. It's from the Bible.
Right.
Okay, now we're asked a question. God cursed Cain with famine. Cain is not happy with God and thinks that God is too mean to him. Now, let's look at this, because I don't know if I put notes on it. So, let's look at this curse here. What have you done? Listen to me. Because Cain lied. And if Cain wouldn't have lied to God, God wouldn't be this severe. Now, he said, your brother's blood cries out to me, because God knew. And that's what I'm telling you. Your brother's blood's crying out to me. He knew. And blood is basically life in a person. So when blood comes out of a person, that's sort of life coming out of them. That's why when Jesus died on the cross, he shed his blood. He shed his life. And that's why blood's got such a powerful meaning. And when they do sin offerings, it's the blood, it's a sin offering, because blood represents life. Now you're under a curse, driven from the ground, which opens its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hands. When you work the ground, now remember with Adam, he allowed plants to grow, but it also grew with thistles. So it was going to be rough for Adam after his sin, but he still allowed plants to grow. It just he had thorns and bushels that grew up along with it, which made it rough. Now listen to this one. It will no longer yield its crop for you. So basically saying you're not going to be able to grow anything. It's going to be a famine. You will be restless wanderers on the earth. Means he's going to be homeless. He's not going to be allowed to stay in a place for too long. He's allowed to wander the earth. Then listen to this. Cain says to the Lord, my punishment is more than I can bear. Today you are driving me from the land, which is true. He's making him homeless. And I will be hidden from your presence. That was a lie. God never said he wouldn't be in his presence. He just said he won't be able to grow anything or stay anywhere for a long period of time. I will be a restless wanderer on this earth, which is true. He's going to be basically homeless. Now, this one's the biggest lie of all. And whoever finds me will kill me, and we're going to get into that in just a minute, but God didn't say that. Yeah. Yeah, and he does, and instead of, I think you're using the same David Guzik as well. It seems like you're getting a lot of the same stuff that he says too. But yeah, he cries out of pity instead of out of repentance. He just more, oh, poor me, instead of, crap, Lord, I am so sorry I messed up. No, he's like, oh, poor me, God, that's too much. He doesn't even admit that he's earning it. He just like, God, that's too mean. Alright, we're going to end it there. That's not all, folks. And good, we still got 20 minutes yet, so we're still going to be under the hour, so that's good.
Don't touch that mouth.
I didn't put that on this one.
But
I kind of cut this one in half because this is about midpoint, and if we were to go any further into this one, the next week would be quite a bit shorter. So this kind of puts us in the middle. I was really hoping to get to this, but you know what? Spoiler. I'm going to give a little bit of a spoiler, and we're going to discuss it next week. But I just want something for you to ponder all week. Where did Cain get his wife? And I'm going to ask you guys this again next week. Where did Cain get his wife? Okay. Do you suppose his wife could be his sister?
What?
Well, think about it. And we're going to discuss some more next week. But think about it. Adam and Eve, Cain, Abel, and Seth. And then, well, I'll go ahead and jump into Genesis chapter 5 real quick. That'll shed a little bit of light on this study for you. Give me 1 second, and I think it's Genesis 5. Yep, okay. So Genesis chapter 5, verse 3, when Adam lived 130 years, and we don't know how old he was when he had Cain, but we know when he was 130 years old, he had a son in his own likeness, in his own image, and he named him Seth. After Seth was born, Adam lived 800 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Adam lived a total of 930 years, and then he died. So it doesn't tell you how many kids and sons, but it does say after Adam lived 800 years and had other sons and daughters, so he had to have had, for Cain to get his wife, Adam and Eve would have had to have other kids after Cain and Abel before Seth. So I'm going to leave you with that to ponder all week. And we'll get to it next week. But I'm just going to leave you with that. Just something to look forward to next week. A little suspense. Yeah, and back then it wasn't a sin to marry your sister and have and make babies with your sister. We'll put it that way. I'm trying to put it in a polite way.
Right.
So, all right, so that's all we got today. Any more comments or anything before we end in prayer?
No. Oh, I do have one comment. It's my uncle's birthday today. You can have it. Sorry, okay. Thank you, Lord, for having us study your word. Help us gain the knowledge for this week and bring us back together next week. We'll judge you. I miss you very much. May you rest in peace, and I'll see you soon. Amen.
Give us the wisdom to understand and open our eyes.
I thank you for Peter, Johnny, and Brenda, Lord. And Lord, I just pray that these words that we read through the Bible, Lord, that we get a better understanding of what it is that you're trying to tell us, Lord. Lord, and I strongly feel that you're really speaking to us today about anger, on it. We need to work on our anger, that when we give in to anger, we're just giving Satan a foothold, Lord. And we need to not give Satan a foothold. When we see anger coming up, we need to be slow to anger, Lord. We need to be quick to pray to you to take that anger, take that urge away, Lord. That we don't just give in to our first thoughts, that we actually think things through before we act. And Lord, look after these people who's dealing with this hurricane, Lord. Lord, look after the pastors that's out there trying to spread the word, Lord. We know their job ain't easy. And Lord, this tithing and offering that you continue to lay in our hearts, Lord, that you allow us to give what we can give and what you want us to give, and that we give faithfully, and we don't give just because you told us to give. We give because we want to give to you, Lord. And we don't give just to see what you can give us back, because, Lord, we know that you can give us back way more than what we give you. That when we give our tithes, in either in money or in time, Lord, that we're just giving back to you. Lord, we can never pay you back for what you've done for us, Lord, that you continue to bless us, even when we don't deserve it. And you prove that over and over again, Lord. I just pray you for everything that you have done and everything that you will do. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen. 10,000 reasons. You can sing along if you want, that's fine.
Bless the Lord, my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new
I'll answer that one later. Yeah, I did. I shut it off. It wasn't working. This will go on Facebook, but I gotta edit it first. Before I cut this off, because I want to keep it under an hour, you know one thing I noticed? And, you know, we prayed that the Lord was going to take care of the echoing. He knows it started echoing, but you notice, I just realized, you notice the echoing went away?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's the answer to prayer right there.
I told you, and I told him in the name of Jesus, the static, get out.
in the name of Jesus.
So I just wanted this to be out there for YouTube and all to know that ask the Lord and he'll answer. And we prayed for the echoiness and he took care of it without us even realizing it. He took care of it because I didn't do anything extra. I went back the old way of doing it and it's not echoing. So
I'm outside. I'm shiny. I'm outside.
You're in heaven, Peter.